Good morning, dear church family. This morning we would consider how we're going to face the future with faith that God will build his church and even the gates of hell will not prevail against it. We're going to consider God's goodness, God's faithfulness that has followed us all the days of our lives. God has always been there for us. Maybe the 11th hour, but he's always been on time. And so we're going to pay tribute to God for his goodness throughout the service. Thank you for coming. I hope this worship service will be a huge blessing to your lives. Steve Godfrey has an announcement for us.
Good morning, First Church. It's great to be here. And I'm Steve Godfrey, and I'm with the leadership team. And I'm very happy to be on the leadership team. Considerations being given to being a servant team, because we are your servants. Announcements, very simple. You have a blue sheet and you're in your bulletin. Please hang on to this. It tells you what's going on. Read it. It's also in the constant contact. It's also on Facebook. If you're not on those, if you're not receiving these via email, contact the church office. They'll let you know. The one that I want to point out to you is the one happening on August 2nd. It's the family picnic, 6 o'clock at Canoe Creek. So main courses and beverage is provided. Please bring a covered dish to share. And after that, we now have the mission trip video.
With shouts of acclamation,
Thanks to all those that went on the trip, and thanks to all of you who supported it in any way. If you will please now stand as you are able for this morning's call to worship, which is responsive. Our comfort zone is a dangerous place. It prevents us from improving. It stops us from achieving all the things we are capable of achieving. No matter where we are today, we have the power to change the direction our lives are going in. All it takes is one decision to move away from what is holding us back. It really is our choice. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make straight your paths. Amen. Please remain standing for our opening hymn, number 136, "The Lord's My Shepherd, I'll Not Want."
Thank you.
your seats. We'll enter into a time of prayer. So if you would please close your eyes and bow your heads. Let's pray for our own needs, whatever you're going through. This is a very intimate time with you and your Heavenly Father. And if there's any need in the family, name them. And claim them for God. Physical needs, spiritual needs. We'll also pray for our circle of friends. Think of some of your friends who asked you to pray for them. Some of them desperately need God's intervention. We'll now pray for our church family. That we would be an instrument of healing to each other and to other broken people around us. Thank God for times like this, for we can identify with others who are going through brokenness and pain. No experience in God's economy is wasted. He's allowed this to happen. So we will be broken and spilt out for Him. Let's pray for those who are going through bereavement and loss. Some too poor to give their loved ones a grand farewell. And let's rejoice with those who are celebrating anniversaries and birthdays. Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need your tender care. In your pleasant pastures, feed us. For thy folds, for thy ewes, thy folds prepare. And we really mean it, Lord. If the Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. Help us to make the shepherd the Lord of our lives. Thank you for each of us gathered here, each with our own testimonies of your goodness, of your grace, of your constancy in the midst of pain. We've gathered together as a household of faith to declare your praises. Thank you for taking us through valley experiences, for we've met you in the valley. Be with us throughout this worship service, that we'll worship you in the beauty of holiness. In Jesus' name we praise you. And all God's people said, Amen. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Good morning. Would you stand as you're able for the scripture reading this morning? There are two readings. The first reading is from Psalm 139, verses 1 through 12, and it's from the New International Version. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths, you're there. If I rise on the wings of dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there, your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me. Even in the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. The second reading is from Psalm 23, verse 6, from the King James Version. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. These are the words of God for the people of God. You may be seated. Thank you.
Friends, a few Sundays ago, we started a series from Psalm 23. And I've got some feedback, and I realized that when I started off with Psalm 23, that we would continue for at least 2 months or perhaps even 3 months, because there's so much stuff in Psalm 23. It's loaded with truth. But then after getting feedback, the Psalm suggested I move on to other passages in Scripture, and some suggested the epistles and Gospels. So we would be moving, and this would be my conclusion of Psalm 23. But those of you who want to plumb its depths, who want to really sink your teeth into this psalm, please contact me. And for the next few weeks, we're going through a lot of transition. And I would soon be starting a Bible study. And those of you who are interested, please contact Chrissy, our secretary, and she'll let me know, and we'll choose a mutually convenient time, a day, and we could meet for studying not just Psalm 23, but whatever passage you want to study, we'd study that passage. If we have to go into Hebrew and Greek, and if you want to do that, we can do that as well. I don't know, some of you may know of this older lady in her 80s who wanted to get married for the fourth time in her life. And everyone was surprised that she was getting married for the fourth time. In her 20s, she got married to a banker. In her 40s, she got married to a Broadway singer. In her 60s, she got married to a preacher. And now in her 80s, she got married to a funeral director. A friend was very surprised and she stopped her and asked, "Why four marriages? And why this array of people, differing careers?" And she said, "Don't you get it? It's one for the money, the banker, two for the show, the Broadway singer, three to get ready, the preacher, and four to go." Who said it? If you fail to plan, you plan to fail. I think it was Benjamin Franklin who coined that phrase in the late 1700s. Winston Churchill popularized it in the Second World War. But what we could do as God's people is consult God's word. In Jeremiah 29 and verse 11, we read, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord." God has plans for each one of us, plans to prosper us and not to harm us. Wow. Plans to give us a hope and a future. We are thinking of our future. So we face our future with faith that God has everything in control, because no experience in God's economy is wasted. Consider these words that are on your screen. "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life." Let's look at that first phrase first. Track with me as we unpack as much as we can from these words. Notice the word "surely." It is a definite thing. God's goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And as I said in last evening's service and the two services that preceded this service, look over your shoulder at all what you've been through in life. The good, the bad, the in-between, all the experiences you've been through in life. How would you summarize it? I've known you for less than a month, but I know this about you. Many things have come, many things have gone in your lives. Recently, a family breakdown, the church family. A lot of you are going through pain, but this thing is sure. God's goodness, God's mercy has followed you every single day of your life. Correct. Every single day of your life, God's goodness, God's mercy has followed you. I think it was John Stott who called these two, goodness and mercy, the hound dogs of heaven. They've chased after you. Constantly, God's goodness and mercy, correct me if I'm wrong, my friend, if not for God's mercy, you wouldn't be sitting there. If not for God's mercy, would I be standing here? God's goodness, God's mercy followed us every single day of our lives. Notice those beautiful words. Surely goodness and mercy. Surely. Not punctuated goodness, not punctuated mercy,
but permanent goodness, permanent mercy, persistent goodness. He pursues you. Persistent mercy. The constancy of God, God's goodness and mercy has followed you all the days of your life. A pastor friend of mine from Boise, Idaho, we were talking. And we were talking about several things, and we came to this verse. And he pointed out to me how God's goodness pursues us. And then when his goodness catches us, he handcuffs us with his mercy. How beautiful to be handcuffed with God's mercy. Why are you here in church this morning? Because you've experienced God's goodness, correct? Time and time and time again, and you've experienced God's mercy. God's goodness and mercy followed us every single day of our lives. When you read the pages of the Old Testament, from Genesis 1 to Malachi chapter 4, all 39 books of the Old Testament, especially if you read it in the Old Testament language, Hebrew, very, very interesting. You get two words constantly. One is the word hen in Hebrew, which means faithfulness. Another is the word hesed. Say hesed. Hesed. Which also means faithfulness. Throughout the Old Testament, you get hen, hesed, hen, hesed, constantly when you read the Holy Bible in the Hebrew language, the Old Testament. Why two words for the same word, faithfulness? Because of this, my friend. The word hen refers to God's faithfulness. Hesed is man's faithfulness, the faithfulness of Israel, the nation of Israel, to God. Why is God's faithfulness one thing and man's faithfulness another thing? The answer is very simple. Has God been faithful to you every single day of your life? Have you been faithful to God every single day of your life? That's the difference. Ours is hesed. His is constant hen faithfulness. Is God unchanging? Yes? No, you're wrong. God is not unchanging. God is unchangeable. His character will never change. His goodness will never change. His mercy will never change. And His goodness and mercy not only follows you all the days of your life, but it goes ahead of you. 10 years from now, you would still say, God's goodness and mercy is following me. If the Lord tarries and you're still alive, 30 years from now, you'd say the same thing. God's goodness, it goes before you. You're surrounded by God's goodness, by God's mercy. How wonderful. Isn't it beautiful? Amen. And here, consider this. God's goodness, God's mercy. Lamentations 3:23. Thy compassions, they fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. His compassions, they do not fail. His mercies, you've experienced it, are new every morning. And His faithfulness, great is His faithfulness. We sing the hymn, "Great is Thy Faithfulness." What is the last line of the first stanza? "As Thou hast been, Thou for." Thank you. "Ever wilt be." Has He been faithful? Yes. "As He has been." Oh, wonderful is this. "As He has been, He for ever will be faithful to you." Do you want anything more, church? If God is faithful, if He's guaranteeing you His faithfulness, what have we to fear? Did He not say that I will build my church and even the gates of hell cannot prevail against it? He's the builder. Let's be on His team. The leaders from the leadership team who are essentially servant leaders who want to help you in every way possible. As we meet and discuss, we realize that we are in the cusp of something wonderful that God is doing in our midst. We want to be on God's team. Let Him build the church. We march to the beat of a different drummer. If I'm planning against the grain of God's word, show me the door. Let's follow His lead. And if the leadership needs your help, please go out of your way. We are going to gather together and build God's church as He is the chief shepherd. I'm just His under shepherd. He is the builder, the master builder. Now, God's goodness and mercy follows us every single day of our lives. I think I was talking to the Sunday before last. I was talking to someone after the first service, the 8 o'clock service. And the person spoke about favorite hymns. And she told me that her favorite hymn was "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing." And I was telling the previous service friends who attended church at the 9:30 service, the fourth stanza is really beautiful, correct? In "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing." "Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee, prone to wander. Lord, I feel it. Prone to wander. Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Take my heart. Oh, take and seal it for thy courts above. Thy goodness and mercy has followed us every single day. We respond by saying, oh, take my heart, take and seal it for your service, God. Whatever you want me to do, I'll do it for you. I cannot outgive you." And then we quickly come to the second phrase. I keep telling my friends over and over again, how can we just skip that first phrase and so easily go into the second phrase when there's so much in the first phrase? "And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Remember Psalm 84 and verse 10? Psalm 84 and verse 10. I'd rather be a doorkeeper. A doorkeeper, correct? Yes, someone said it. In the house of the Lord than to dwell in the tents, in the courts, the tabernacle of the wicked. I'd rather be a doorkeeper. Which is better, to be a doorkeeper, a watchman, a sweeping lady in God's house? Which is better, to be a doorkeeper in God's house or to be a king in the courts of the wicked, in the palaces of the wicked? Which is better? A doorkeeper. Let's be doorkeepers. Before you come into church, let's do two things. Let's keep our egos outside and come without anything, just to serve Him. My friend Wesley's here, namesake, searching for God. Found Him at the altar. I forget which day, Wesley. Searching for God. How many Wesleys are there? He'll tell you, hundreds and hundreds, searching for God. Oh, for the day when we'll all be a group of prayer warriors. Wesley'll never forget that day when a group of people just gathered around him and showered love on him. That's why he's here. He was broken. He's never seen, he said, a group like this that can just love him unconditionally. Guess why God's taking us through hurt and pain? So we can understand the hurt and pain of others, such as Wesley. Thank God for pain. Don't waste your pain. Use your pain to serve others. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Being a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord, good, but very shallow interpretation. Because the word for house in Greek is oike, from where we get ecumenical. Oike is house. Your eternal house. Heaven is your proper home. This world is not your home. Look at this God that we serve. He takes care of you in the here every single day, and He takes care of you in the hereafter, and you will dwell in His house forever. You close your eyes here and you open your eyes there. Your loved ones have not gone. They are dwelling in God's house forever, waiting for you. Beautiful. Beautiful. Heaven, a permanent home. When I was little, I would hear these words, lift me up above the shadows of this world. This world is just a shadow. It's not the real deal. Lift me up, dear Lord, and let me stand on the mountaintop of glory. Let me dwell in Beulah land. Beulah land, heaven. Tamil is a very intense language. Much, much, much older than the English language. I dared it last evening. I could not dare it in the previous service, but I choose to do it again this morning at this service because someone told me to. After the 9:30 service, who were there for the 6 o'clock service last evening. Beautiful words. I know you have great singers. Marty would be singing his song, his sacrifice of praise to God soon after we hear God's word. We have Ross there. We have many beautiful singers. Don't take rotten tomatoes and throw it here, but I'm trying. In Tamil, it goes this way. Thookidom, irulin endrum, thookidom, yenerkawe, magimayen, kudumadil, bulana tilvalavel, thookidom. Irulenendrum tukidom yenerkawe magimayen kudumadil bulana tilvalavel. Lift me up, Lord, above the shadows. Lift me up, dear Lord, dear Lord. And let me stand on that mountain top of glory. Let me dwell in Beulah land. This world is full of pain. Beulah land is not. Let's long for our proper home, church, heaven. And that's why Fanny Crosby wrote these beautiful words, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Oh, I wish we could really do that, praising our Savior all the day long. Is our praising him proportionate to his goodness and mercy? No. Who is a Christian? A Christian is one who is a Christian in the dark when no one is watching. And that's why Psalm 139, which was read to us, verses 5 and 6, O Lord, you hem me in behind and before. You lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. O God, you have laid your hand upon me behind and before. Look at the psalm that we've considered, just the tip of the iceberg. The first Sunday we considered God anointing his sheep's head with oil, remember? You anoint my head with oil. God's hand is above you. He takes you, he makes you lie down in green pastures, God's hand beneath you. He leads you beside, God's hand beside you, God's hand above you, God's hand beneath you, God's hand beside you. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. God's hand behind you. The table is spread before you in the presence of your enemies. And now God's hand beyond you, preparing a place for you to dwell in his house forever. God above you, God beneath you, God beside you, God behind you, God before you, God beyond you. Do you need anything more? Tell me. Anything. You've got it all in the here and the hereafter. Isn't our God beautiful? Isn't he worthy of worship? Should we give him our all? He's asking friends, if God builds a house for you, how strong will it be? How strong will it be? Tell me. Strongest. What if God Himself is your house? How strong will that be? That's what Psalm 90 and verse 1 says. O Lord, You are our dwelling place. God is our dwelling place. He is our house. Forever. Oh God, You have been our dwelling place for all generations. Your generation, your parents' generation, your grandparents' generation, 10 generations before You, God has been our dwelling place. We are in a safe place as long as we are in God. Paul, talking to the Stoic and Epicurean philosophers in Acts 17, he's talking to them. And then he quotes one of their own poets named Epimendes, a Cretan philosopher, and he says these words that are so familiar, for in Him we live and move and have our being. As one of your own poets have said, we are God's offspring, quoting Epimendes. In God we live, in God we move, in God we have our being, in God is our dwelling place. Where can we run from God? Try running from God, my friend, you'll run to God. This is not talking about the omnipresence of God. It's talking about the persistent presence of God. Big difference. He pursues you. When you wanted to throw in the towel, when you said, I've had enough, He didn't let you go. Newsflash, if you jump from God, you fall onto His lap. The whole of this beautiful psalm hangs, is predicated on that first line, the Lord is my shepherd. Therefore He restores your soul. Therefore He spreads a table before you. Therefore He anoints your head with oil. A baby stops crying when it hears the voice of the mother. We sheep stop our frightful bleating when we hear the voice of our shepherd. Beautiful voice, softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. Facing the future in faith. This poor girl, we wind up with this. This poor girl met me in a place called Ranchi, Bihar, where I had to speak at a youth meeting, a youth retreat that lasted 1 week. I was going back to a place called Calcutta, the headquarters of the Sisters of Charity, where Mother Teresa has her headquarters. The Sisters of Charity, now run by Nirmala, her hand-picked successor, Sister Nirmala. While I was in Ranchi and I finished that youth camp and I was about to get onto the train, I saw a little girl running with a scroll in her hand, and she gave it to me. And she said, it's for you, in her language, the language of Bihar in Ranchi. I got onto the train and I opened that little poster that she gave me. It was a beautiful Indian village scene with mountains and a river and a well and a beautiful village scene. And on the top right hand corner were these words, church, don't forget these words. An ordinary little girl gave me this poster. I had it for many, many years, but then it was too tattered.
The top right-hand corner, it read, you can never get lonely because you can never get alone. You can never get lonely because you can never be alone. He's always with you. Wonderful. My daughter was very little, and I taught her, she liked poetry, so I taught her the Psalms. Psalm 1, Psalm 103, Psalm 90, Psalm 91. Whenever it came to Psalm 23, she would refuse. Something would distract her. So I sat her down one day and I said, you're going to tell me all the 6 verses. She started off very well. Must have been 6, 7, 8. And then she said, the Lord is my shepherd. And friends called her and she said, that's enough. And she ran away. And I began to cry. You'd wonder why. Because of those very words, if the Lord is your shepherd, that's enough. Beautiful. If the Lord is your shepherd, that's enough. That's enough. What more do you need? Tell me. He's your shepherd. He'll take care of you in the here, in the hereafter. He's taken care of everything. And we are cribbing over what we are going through now. He's going to take care of this as well. He's in control. Let him have the wheel. There was this Shakespearean actor who had this amazing ability to recite these classics. And after every performance, he would conclude it by saying the Shepherd's Psalm. The crowd would be quiet for a while. And then they would rise in thunderous applause as he concludes the psalm. One night, as he was about to perform before one audience, an old man came to him. This Shakespearean actor had an amazing ability to bring life to the verse. And this man says, sir, tonight can I recite Psalm 23? This professional, trained actor felt sorry for the old man because he would embarrass himself before such a big audience. And he said, can you really do it? And he said, okay. And he sat down and he knew that this unskilled man couldn't do anything, but he thought after he finishes, he'll come and do it. And then this man said in his quiet, faltering, stammering voice, he recited the whole of Psalm 23. There was no applause. There was no standing ovation. All people could hear was the sound of weeping. There was not one dry eye in that room. This trained actor was shocked. He told this man, tell me how you did it. I've been performing this for years and years and years, and I've never been able to move an audience like this. What is your secret? I've never been able to move an audience to tears. How did you do it? Guess what the old man said. Sir, you know the psalm. I've met the shepherd. Have you? Have you met the shepherd? The Lord will be your shepherd only if you make the shepherd your Lord. Are you ready to make him the Lord of your life today? Yesterday was a beautiful experience. There are some here who saw it. How many of you here are willing to give your entire lives to Jesus unconditionally? Can I see hands? Thank you. Is he worthy of giving your life unconditionally? Yes or no? Does he deserve it? Once we give it to him, how well will he use our lives? Better than we can use our own lives, correct? Those who raised your hands, please stand up. Stand up. Have the guts to stand up. Let's give our lives to him. Who is on the piano? Jeffrey, can you try I Surrender All? We haven't done this unrehearsed, unplanned, but we're going to sing it from our hearts and really surrender and let him use us to build this church for him. I surrender all. Just the chorus. Some of you are singers, so you can sing. Let Jeffrey give us the cue. Close your eyes, bow your heads down, and sing it from your hearts. You've heard our prayer, and we sang this from our hearts. You've surrendered your all. We are just specks of dust. Even if we give our all, it does not equate. But take us and use us for the building of your holy church. Use us in spite of us. We make you the Lord of our lives, the captain of the ship. We surrender our lives. We don't put coins or notes in the offertory plate. We put our lives on the offertory plate. Take our lives and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. We thank you for this beautiful time. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated and receive this sacrifice of praise from the lips of Marty. Thank you.
Christ the shore and the steady anchor in the fury of the storm. When the winds of doubt blow through me, when my sails have all been torn, in the suffering, in the sorrow, when my sinking hopes are few, I will hold fast to the anchor, it will never be removed. Christ the shore and the steady anchor, while the tempest rages on. When temptation claims the battle, and it seems the night is won. Deeper still then goes the anchor, though I justly stand accused. I will hold fast to the anchor, it shall never be removed. Christ the shore and the steady anchor, through the floods of unbelief. Hopeless somehow, oh my soul, now lift your eyes to Calvary. This my ballast of assurance, see his love forever proved. I will hold fast to the anchor, it will never be removed. Christ the shore and the steady anchor, as we face the wave of death. when these trials give way to glory and we draw our final breath, we will cross that great horizon, clouds behind and life secure, and the calm will be the better through the storms that we endure. For the storms.
Father, all that is in heaven and on earth belongs to you, and of your own we give back a portion back to you. Take this offertory from our broken hearts, from our little hands. Take it, break it, multiply it, and use it in the lives of broken people, in the congregation and outside. Build your church, Lord. Make us strong, Lord. Join our hearts, Lord, to your Son. Thank you for giving us this great privilege to participate in your kingdom concerns. Bless everyone who gave. And even those who could not give, take this offertory and use it only for one thing, for your glory alone. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, Amen.
Please remain standing for this prayer of surrender to God. Join me. Father, as we close this worship service, we praise you for your goodness and mercy. You are our God, and we submit our loyalty and adoration to you. You existed before time and created everything that exists. We acknowledge that you are the only living God. Father, you are compassionate and merciful, slow to get angry, and abounding with unfailing love. You are good to everyone, and you shower compassion on all of your creation. We promise that we will keep your commandments, walk in your ways, and revere you. Father, we recognize that your instructions are perfect, bringing joy to our hearts. Your word is more desirable than gold, yes, even the finest gold. Your word warns us, and we expect great reward as we adhere to it. Your goodness and love has followed us all the days of our lives, and you have promised us that we will dwell in your eternal house forever. We will bless you at all times and constantly speak of your praises. Amen. Please remain standing for the closing hymn, number 701, When We All Get to Heaven.
His grace and power.
let's receive God's benediction. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of God our Father, and may the constant fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of us from this day until we all get to heaven and sing the shouts of victory. What a day of rejoicing that'll be when we see our loved ones and you face to face and tell that story, only a sinner saved by grace. We thank you, Lord, for making us your children. And we know the high cost of free grace. It took us to become your children. It took us your life. And we'll forever be indebted to you. For those who gave their lives as full surrender to you, we commit them in a very special way for your full, beautiful service. We praise you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen. Church, I want to wish you a blessed week. And please share the story of Jesus with someone this week and bring them next week. The leaders would be with me at the entrance and we would love to meet you. Whatever you need, please share it with us. And please come to that door, those of you who are sitting here, so we get to meet you and talk to you. Steve's with us and Malin's with us and whoever is in the leadership, if I'm not able to spot you, please come with me so we can wish our beautiful church family together. Thank you.
Yeah. give you my heart. In you alone I find my joy. For you alone I count it all loss and surrender everything to you. For your glory,
for your glory,
for your kingdom,
for your kingdom,
for your
here I am.